I saw Lenny Kravitz in the prelude to the Champions League final, and it was slightly disconcerting that he doesn't seem to have aged in the 33 years since our first shoot, his first in the UK that I did in 1991 for the NME. We were at the start of our careers. We were both in our 20s. He was pretty much unknown, and it was a modest affair in a little alley off the Portobello Road. I ran an extension cable out through the PR office window to power my solo studio light, which was mounted on a stand. I used it with a brolly to soften and reflect the light back. By this stage, I'd moved from my Rolleiflex, twin lens reflex, to my first serious camera, a Hasselblad. And I shot color transparency film, which is something I haven't really talked about, but it was a sort of precursor. All photographers shot on color transparency before we started, a lot of us, to move to neg, because color transparency, you had to be right on the money with regard to exposure. I then shot a couple of rolls of black and white, Agfa APX, which, truth be told, the NME were more likely to run. Back then, you got the modest sum of £25 to cover your film and processing. The total amount you got depended on how big the pictures were used in the magazine. You might also get a little bit more for color. For a cover, you'd get £500, which was a small fortune back then for a naive country boy like me. Unfortunately for me and a lot of the other photographers, the Manchester-based photographer Kevin Cummings tended to get most of the well-paid gigs, most of the covers. He was a forceful presence, older, more mature, and fair enough, smart enough to attend the production meetings where most of the editorial decisions about who would do what were made. The rest of us had to make do with photographic crumbs from his table. I remember going all the way to San Francisco, which was fantastic, you know, for a 21-year-old, but I spent the week there and I ended up getting paid £75. I was photographing a band called Jellyfish. It wasn't sustainable. And the lack of meritocracy can be disheartening. It's annoying if you shoot, as I did, a cover. My first cover was of Bobby Gillespie of Primal Scream. And it was a great cover and it worked really, really well. And then you're not rewarded with more covers. You go back to shooting, you know, these smaller jobs. So NME was published by IPC magazines, and they were based at King's Reach Tower in SE1, Southeast London. And in the centre of town, you had EMAP Metro, and they published Select and Q magazine. And I started to work for them. And they had a day rate of £250, or £125 for a half day. You didn't feel like you were going under. You weren't an amateur. You weren't doing it for the love of it. You know, you were properly remunerated. Also, the paper on which my images appeared was nicer. The first shoot with Kravitz was fleeting. And looking at the pictures, I made a rookie mistake. It wouldn't be the first time a picture editor would say, "Did you take any pictures of him without his sunglasses?" It's really important to get a variety of imagery when you're doing a portrait shoot. And what could easily happen is things are going well, there's great rapport, you're getting good pictures, you know you're getting good pictures, and you get complacent. And then you end up taking four rolls of essentially the same image. Not much variation in expression either. I mean, I think that's probably Lenny's shtick, but I'll cut myself some slack. We were both at the start of our careers. As his reputation grew, even though the shoot was pretty pedestrian, this first shoot, I decided to put the image in my portfolio. And back then, it was before I had a scanner or anything. And I remember I paid someone to scan the image, and we messed around on screen with this image. We changed all the curves. I mean, looking back, the picture looks ridiculous. I was sort of trying to make it cross-processed in a way. But it was the first time I came across this program called Photoshop. By the way, I'm not sponsored by Photoshop, but it is the program I've used to edit my pictures all these years. A lot has happened in the 7 years before we reconvene in the Bahamas. I've got married, I'm now a father, and he's become a global superstar. We are staying in the Compass Point Beach Resort, right in front of the ocean. And I count William Leith, the writer, and Claire Hajad, the PR, as my friends. It was a great jolly. Lenny's there to record a video for his latest single, You Belong to Me. The photographer, Mark Seeliger, is directing. He's a sort of male Annie Leibovitz and definitely un grand fromage. Definitely a bigger cheese than me. It's going to be interesting to see how this pans out, but he's very New York, very professional, not interested in talking to me or being friends. I'm definitely competition. The light is really harsh during the day, so we spend the time snorkeling and smoking cigarettes. It's kind of like a holiday, except it's not, because in the back of my mind, getting my pictures is always there, niggling. In the evening, we hang around watching the filming. Much to Seeliger's annoyance, I get little Lenny moments in the dappled evening light. An old bike that someone's left in the street makes an authentic prop for me to shoot Lenny leaning against. And then I find a mural with Haile Selassie, the last Ethiopian emperor, and I shoot him against that. Anything to give my pictures something of a unique feel. I'm concerned that my portraits will look like stills from the video shoot. So to that end, I asked Claire if we can have our own number. And maybe, it just occurred to me, spur of the moment thing, why can't we get Lenny in the sea? It's something that I've done over the years. I like getting people in the water. I don't know why. I just think it makes a nice... I do know why, actually. I think, like I've talked about the fact that certain images are always there in your subconscious, getting you to recreate them. And I think it's a picture by Sally Mann of her son Emmett in the water. It's so beautiful. I mean, it's shot on 10x8. It's an amazing picture. And I think it kind of influenced me. And so I shot Jamie Cullum the same way. And I do try and get people into the water. And I think Lenny was one of the first. She agrees to ask him, and slightly grumpy, but he goes along with it and it's arranged. I'm gonna be doing my own shoot in the sea after breakfast before we leave for the airport. The following morning, as we eat our breakfast al fresco, Lenny is at the adjacent table with a breathtakingly beautiful woman who's not Natalie Imbruglia, who is supposedly his current girlfriend, according to the tabloids. What a life he leads. I bide my time, and suddenly it's happening. I'm getting what I wanted. I'm getting my shoot. We're at the water's edge, and he somewhat surprisingly gingerly enters the water. I was expecting him to run in a kind of earthy manner. But we're there, we're in the water, all systems are go. It's a bit like you've got a penalty to win the match in the last minute, and all you have to do is convert, except it's easier than scoring a penalty, you know, with the crowd and stuff. I've got all my cameras, my Pentax 6-7, my Fuji rangefinder, my Hasselblad. William and Claire are holding my equipment on the beach, and I'm sort of wading in. I wish somebody had taken a photograph because it would have looked really funny. Lenny there with his incredible 8-pack, and me, my belly still full from the massive breakfasts that I tended to consume whenever I was staying in a hotel back then. When you're in your 20s, you kind of make hay when the sun shines. The sea is like a mill pond, and the light, although not perfect, has yet to become sort of harsh and contrasty. I've got to be quick, because soon the sun will burn through the mist, and suddenly the light that there is will become unusable. We're both in the water, and his lithe body is emerging from the salty brine. I've got to be slightly wary, because although the water is relatively still, I don't want a wave to suddenly slop casually over my camera and ruin everything. I take all the usual homoerotic, Athena-type poster images that I've sort of seen over the years. You know, you do it, you're sort of on autopilot. It's there, it's the most obvious thing to do. And then finally, I relax and I see the boat on the horizon. And into my mind pops the film Dead Calm, suspense thriller with Sam Neill and Nicole Kidman and Billy Zane. And the plot turns in that film when a solitary boat is sort of seen on the horizon, a foreboding presence. And suddenly the movie switches into sort of a terrifying ordeal. I won't spoil it for anyone, but visually, the sparseness of that movie and the atmosphere and the sense of menace was quite interesting. And with that in mind, I suddenly told Lenny to get down in the water, hide his magnificent form under the water as though he was swimming. And suddenly he was connected to the boat, and suddenly the pictures had a sense of narrative, a sense of enigma, mystery, ambiguity. It's always the case, and I've said this before, less is more. It's really exciting when you get something you hadn't expected, you hadn't planned for. It's just there, it all comes together in that moment. And then, just as quickly, I realize my head is burning, my back is burning, I'm getting burnt by the sun, and Lenny's had enough, and it's over. And it's sort of like, I have a sense of kind of complete relief. I've got my picture, and I've also got something quite interesting at the same time. In the taxi on the way home, all the tension is gone. I'm looking forward to getting home and getting back to normality. You know, watching EastEnders. I don't want to be Lenny Kravitz, you know. I just want to get back to my wife and my daughter and our little house in Hackney. I've had a sort of magical experience, you know, an insight into the Lenny world, but that's enough for me. The takeaway is, and I've said this before, less is more. All the elements were there to take, you know, good pictures, okay pictures. Pictures that everyone expects, and they would get reproduced and they're fine. You know, an amazing location. You've got good light. You've got like an extraordinary looking human being. But actually the pictures that resonate for me are the images that have that mystery, that aren't just one note, that you could live with them and you could look at the image and ask yourself questions. What does it mean? It's not simply a photographer doing the obvious. And again, reflecting on the second set, I hadn't learned any lessons. Most of the pictures, he's wearing his sunglasses.